There's a God who knows it all. There's a God who knows it all.
This one now.
Now sometime my friend abuse me, and sometime they scandalize my name, and sometimes so I go on and I'll take the blame. There's a God who knows it all. Yeah, the God. Ooh.
What key is that? C. C? Oh, go B flat. Let me hear B flat. That's it. Hush. Hush. Somebody's calling my name. Hush. Hush. Somebody's calling my name. Oh Lord. Hush. Hush. Somebody calling my name. Oh my Lord. Oh my Lord. What shall I do? What shall I do? Ooh, so glad. So glad. I got my religion on time. Oh, so glad, so glad. Got my religion on time, my Lord. Oh, so glad, so glad. Got my religion on time. Oh my Lord, oh my Lord, what shall I do? What shall I do? Let me see. I'm so glad, I'm so glad. Trouble don't last always. So glad, so glad that trouble don't last always, my Lord. Oh, I'm so glad, I'm so glad. That trouble don't last always. Oh my Lord, oh my Lord, what shall I do? What? Let me see if you know this one. Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Can I get a witness from somebody out there? Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Hey, Jesus on the main. Yeah. This morning. Speak, Lord, for we thy servants hear thee. Speak to the men today. Speak to the boys today. Speak to the church today. Speak to this city, O Lord. Speak to this nation. Oh Lord, we all await to hear a word from you. Lord, can't nobody do it like you. And we can't make it with nobody else but you. So God, we pray as we come together that you bless this word. We pray it in Jesus' name. Let the church say, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Did y'all miss me? I know I miss y'all. Amen. Amen. I'm always happy to do the will of God. Amen. Amen. But every now and then it's great to be back home. Amen. Amen. Pastor, know what I'm talking about. Amen. Praise the Lord. And want you to pray for the St. John Missionary Baptist Church right up the street. They need your prayers. Want you to pray for Minister Art Gordon. Yeah, he needs your prayers. And guess what? I need your prayers as well. Amen. Amen. I want you to grab your Bibles and hold them up. If you don't have a Bible, grab the pew Bible that's in front of you and lift it up and repeat after me. This is my Bible. And this is my guide to living. Say it louder. This is my Bible. This is my guide to living. Amen. Praise the Lord. Could you stand with me as we turn to the book of Acts in the 8th chapter? Want to thank God for the men's fellowship for allowing me to come and to speak before you this morning. Brother Sidney Burden, Brother Lopez, Brother Montgomery, Brother Gonson, and all of the men as a part of the fellowship. Amen. I want to thank God for this choir that sang today. Amen. They trying to be cute up here, smiling and singing. And that boy with that little squall that he had. Woo! They sang today, y'all. I don't care what anybody said, they sang today. I'm going to read again from the 8th chapter of Acts. Won't be before you long, but we do want to read this passage of scripture. We thank God for Reverend Bodrick for his insightful reading of the scripture. And we start again from verse 5. And when you have it, say amen. Amen. Philip went down to a city in Samaria and proclaimed the Messiah there. When the crowds heard Philip, saw the signs he performed, they all paid close attention to what he said. For with shrieks, impure spirits came out of many, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. And so there was great joy in that city. Now, for some time, a man named Simon had practiced sorcery in the city and amazed all the people of Samaria. He boasted that he was someone great. And all the people, both high and low, gave him their attention and exclaimed, "This man is rightly called the great power of God." They followed him because he had amazed them for a long time with his sorcery. But when they believed Philip as he proclaimed the good news of the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Simon himself believed and was baptized, and he followed Philip everywhere, astonished by the great signs and miracles he saw. When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to Samaria. When they arrived, they prayed for the new believers there that they might receive the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit had not yet come upon any of them, they had simply been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John placed their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Verse 18. When Simon saw that the Spirit was given at the laying on of the apostles' hands, he offered them money and said, "Give me also this ability so that everyone on whom I may lay hands on may receive the Holy Spirit." Peter answered, "May your money perish with you, because you thought you can buy the gift of God with money. You have no part or share in this ministry because your heart is not right before God. Repent of this wickedness and pray to the Lord in the hope that he may forgive you for having such a thought in your heart. For I see that you are full of bitterness and captive to sin." Then Simon said, verse 24, "Pray to the Lord for me so that nothing you have said may happen to me." If I had subject for you this morning, I would say the cost of being a man. Look at your neighbor and say, cost of being a man. Let me hear the brothers. The cost of being a man. Yeah, that sounds good. Get, put a little bass in it. Say it again. The cost of being a man. Yes. Shall, won't you sit down? Praise the Lord. Now, I need to say to the women in this church, this is Lay Men Sunday. Amen. If you don't mind, I'd like to talk to the brothers. Is that all right? Amen. I don't want nobody complaining, no woman complaining, saying, "He ain't say nothing to me." Well, it's Lay Men Sunday. Amen. Am I right about it? Right. Amen. So I want to say something to the brothers this morning, and it's all right. You may agree with what I have to say. You may not agree with what I have to say. And that's all right. Amen? Amen? Amen. Now, I'm watching all the women, and they kind of shutting down right now. I don't want y'all to fall asleep. I just want y'all to listen in as I talk to the brothers. Is that all right? Amen. All right. All right. Listen. I was early on in my life a singer. I love singing. I sang with groups. I did solos. I did concerts. And I was wrestling with whether or not I was a preacher who sang or was I a singer who preached. Anybody know what I'm talking about? I mean, you know, there's some of the things that you kind of wrestle with. And I was wrestling with that. And you know, back in those days, they don't do it much anymore these days, but they would have concerts for competition. you know, choirs would get together, and man, I know a lot of this happened down south. I don't know if a lot of it happened up here in New England, but I know further down they would have competitions. So choirs would sing, and then, you know, they would get prizes, you know, the grand prize, second place, and then soloists would be in there, and then they would have a prize for the soloists and all of that, you know. And groups, you know, and all of that. And I was in one of those competitions, and I was, you know, singing as a soloist. And I'm just gonna tell you up front, I didn't win anything that day. But I was in the back, it was a theater, and I was in the back, in the wings there, and there was a brother who back in those days, they used to wear double-breasted suits. And, you know, he had this real nice, you know, midnight blue double-breasted suit. And he had a white shirt, but it was a silk white shirt. And he had a what was it called? It was a magenta-colored tie. And, you know, he had it wrapped just so in it. He, you know, he just looked like, you know, the bro right here, because, you know, he always dressed like that. He looking at me smiling right now. He like, yeah, that sound good. But anyway, what I'm trying to say is that and his shoes, you know, as I remember, and I'm not lying to you, the shoes were the same color as the tie, you know, and he was as sharp as a tack, you know, and you know how some folk, they just like, when they know they look good, you know, they just be swaggering like, you know, like they own the whole world, you know what I'm saying? And we all back there, and you know, and they're calling names, and you know, he started like coughing and doing, you know, warm-ups, you know, me, 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 me. You know, me, 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 me. Me, 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 and you know, and I'm just sort of looking at him. And there was one person that was after him, and I had already sung and heard some other folks sing. I knew I wasn't gonna win this one. But this boy thought that he had it in the bag. He thought he had it in the bag. And when he gets out there, he sings his song. And I'll admit, he sounded good. You know, he hit all the notes right and had a big voice, and he had his aunt that was playing for him, and she was playing well, and had a little bit of dramatic in him, you know. I just remember at one note, when he hit the note, he had his hand up like this, and, you know, and then did something like that, and, you know, and he had all the right inflections, all the right attitudes, sounded real good, and he finished singing. The next person who sang was this brother whose suit looked like it came from the Goodwill. Right. Clean though, everything matched. And when he mentioned the church was not the biggest church in the city. Matter of fact, it was one of the smallest churches in the city. And he got in there, and he walked in. I remember looking at him and thinking to myself, it's such a contrast. You had this put-together brother who sang so well, and then you got this brother get out there. And he got out there, and he said, I got this hymn I want to sing. Halfway through that hymn, the whole place was just laid out. Folk were just laid, people were just falling out, you know, and everybody was shouting and all of this, and he ain't even get done singing the song. And when he was done with the song, he just walks off the stage. And he started to leave. And I was like, well, bro, you know, they haven't announced who won the competition. Because I'm thinking it's kind of obvious to me that if you ain't win, you close to it. And I'll never forget, after all these years, what he said. He says, I didn't come here to win a prize. I came here because the Lord asked me to come. And to minister. And I'm done. And he left. I wish I could have took his money. Church, say amen. Amen. That story sort of gets at the heart of what this text is about this morning. Here we have the spread of the gospel. And it is spreading beyond Jerusalem and into Judea and into the uttermost parts of the world. Samaria was in that concentric circle of spreading. And the disciples were being used by God in order to spread this message. And your Bible says that Philip was brought to Samaria. And when he came to Samaria, the wonders and the signs that he performed were so amazing that folk were just thrilled to see this new thing that was happening. And what was interesting about this whole process is that there was another man who did the same thing. And his name was Simon. Simon was a magician, a soothsayer, someone who amazed the crowd with his sorcery. But my Bible said that the folks started following Philip. And then we find out that Simon also started to follow Philip. What's interesting about the text is that it doesn't say that Simon just started following. It says that Simon believed and was baptized. And then he started following Philip wherever Philip went. And as the text goes, you have the word that gets back to Jerusalem that the gospel is spreading beyond the world just like Jesus said it would. And they sent for Peter and John to come and to put the finishing touches on the whole thing. And they laid hands on folks, and people started to receive the Holy Spirit. And when Simon saw that happening, he reached into his pocket, pulled out some ducats, and said to Peter, give me also this ability. How much for this? I want to be able to do what you did. Give me this ability so that everyone in whom I lay my hands on may receive the Holy Spirit. And then Peter answered, well, may your money perish with you because you thought you could buy the gift of God with money. You have no part or share in this ministry because your heart is not right before God. Repent of this wickedness and pray to the Lord in the hope that he may forgive you for having such a thought in your heart. For I see that you are full of bitterness and captive to sin. Now, when you hear other folk preach on Acts, the 8th chapter, they generally at this point tell you that Simon was not a Christian. Matter of fact, there are some who will tell you that because he offered money, that was a sign that he did not really believe. But when I look back on the word believe in the Greek, it's the same word as when the other folk believed. And when I look at the word baptized, it's the same word in which the other folk were baptized. So rather than try to tell you that the reason why Simon did this was because he wasn't saved, I'd rather say to you that he was saved and offered money to the disciples. Now, there may be some of you who say, all right, you know, that really kind of sits strangely inside of you. And I don't know why, because even though you are saved, you can't tell me that you have not sinned since you accepted Jesus. Say amen, lights. Do me a favor. Put your hand on your neighbor's shoulder now. Now push it and tell him to wake up. Just because you see this thing that happened with Simon, it doesn't mean that he doesn't know the Lord. Just because you see this action coming from Simon, it has no bearing on his salvation. I know folk who have been saved who have done worse. Come on, somebody. I'm trying to get somewhere with this, so y'all just bear with me. Look at your neighbor and say, bear with him now. Look at another neighbor and say, I know it's hot, but just bear with him now. The premise that I'm trying to land on right now is that Simon gave this money, and if that offered this money to the disciples, because he's trying to buy the laying on of hands so that folk can receive the Holy Ghost. So if we establish that he is a believer, that means there's something else wrong with Simon that caused Simon to do this. Now, when you look at Peter and his response, he gives you two things. He says down there on the 23rd verse, he says, "For I see that you are full of bitterness and captive to sin." And when you look at Peter's response, what he's trying to say is that, yeah, you know the Lord, but looks like there's some bitterness inside of you. Yeah, you saved, but you are still captive to sin. All right, I'm getting somewhere with this now. Now, you have these two things that come from Peter, and I imagine that the bitterness comes from jealousy. Because here was Simon, he was the great one of God. He was the one who knew the Lord, had the power and the signs and the wonders, and folk looked at him as some great man until the real thing came along. And when the real thing came along, crowds do what they did to him. They just left him and they went towards the real thing. And so there's some jealousy there. And don't tell me you can't be saved and be jealous. I know that happens in the church all the time. Come on, somebody. Don't tell me that you don't walk in the church and there's somebody looking at you strange because of what you got on. Come on, somebody. I'm not looking at anybody right now, but I know that there are some jealousies that go on in the church. Why is he in this position and why am I not in the position? Come on, somebody. Why did the Lord bless him like that? I'm better than him. I should have as much or as more than he has, but it looked like he got more. Yeah, I tell you, it must be a quiet. Since I went up the street, y'all done got quiet on me. I mean, Lord Jesus, all I'm trying to do is preach the word. I know that folk can be saved and jealous at the same time. Folk be going to church for 10, 20, 30 years. Sometimes they get so set in their ways. Come on, somebody. And then when something new come around, you get mad just because it's new. It ain't got nothing to do with you. It may even be a benefit to you, but you mad anyway. Maybe because you're not the head of it. Come on, somebody. And then it says, you are also captive to sin. See, I think that there are folks who are saved, but they haven't progressed in their Christian living because that old nature, come on somebody, tries to pull them back. Can I at least get a witness from somebody out there? There are folk who try to do better, but there's something about the old ways that they still like and don't want to let go, and then they try to live with both at the same time, but they're conflicted in their minds, they're conflicted in their decisions, they're conflicted in their life. The Bible says a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. And so maybe those are the two things that Peter was perceiving. But I think that there's another perception. I think the other perception has to do with something that goes a bit deeper. So I'm just going to lay this one point on you, my brothers. And then I'll be done with the sermonizing. Now, there's something deeper here, my brothers, that we have to be aware of as men of faith. There is a way in which the world defines manhood. And then there's a way that God defines as manhood. And what Simon was wrestling with, and I would say he's wrestling with it, he's wrestling with that one notion of how to transition from being someone who is outside of the faith to somebody who's inside the faith. He's trying to wrestle with the notion of, well, I used to be this way when I was outside, but now I'm inside. So how should I be now? And I think if we're able to understand this deeper point, then we could strengthen our resolve as men of faith. Are you ready for this point? I'm only talking to the brothers. Are you ready for this point? The ladies are just listening to you. Brothers, are you ready for this point? Right, here we go. Here we go now. Here we go. Put your seatbelt on now. Here we go. Here we go now. I think the point that needs to be made, if we're going to be able to progress as men of faith, is that if you're going to be a Christian man, you're going to have to stop trying to be a signs and wonders man. That's my point. Somebody give me a glass of water so I can drink it. If we're going to progress as men of faith, we're going to have to not be like what Simon used to be, a signs and wonders man. You say, well, Reverend, what are you talking about? I'm talking about that ego-driven posturing and positioning, trying to be always at the front of the line, trying to be the biggest and the best, the kind of testosterone-driven egotism that can slip and make us fall as Christian men. That was Simon's problem. Simon, before he knew Christ, was a great man. He was a sorcerer. People loved him. Probably when he went to the restaurant, everybody paid for his food and paid for his drink, and he was well known in the city. But when he decided to follow Jesus, it was a different set of priorities. And when he saw that there was another way of looking at the supernatural, he dug in his pocket and offered money. And he offered the money not because he actually wanted to do this, but he wanted to be known as a great man again. And what we need to understand in this life is that being great by the world's standards is different from being great under God's standards. See, there are some folk who come to church and join the church, and they figure that that same ego-driven way of being a man and the world's standards should apply in the church. Then you got men who start fussing and fighting with each other because they got titles, and there's one person who feel like their title is better than another title. Come on, somebody. They want to be this person. They want to be that person. They want to be a trustee. They want to be a deacon. Come on, somebody. And it's all pushed by this sense of supermanhood. But God has a different way of being a man. It's about humility. It's about realizing that you're not number one, but there is a number one. And his name is Jesus. Can I get a witness from somebody out there? I'm trying to get you to understand that Simon's desire for the laying on of hands was not driven by anything else than his old self trying to pull him back in. But Peter was trying to get him to go a new way. Hallelujah. We got to stop trying to be a sign and a wonder man. We've got to be people of sacrifice. We have to be people of humility. You know, and that applies to every aspect of life. In our relationships. Y'all got quiet on me that time, didn't you? We got to be sacrificial. When you get married, come on now. You'll find this out sooner or later. That the name of the game is compromise. Somebody ought to say amen. When you get married, the things that you used to do, you can't do them no more. Places you used to go, come on somebody. You can't go there no more. And if you try to sneak out, come on. And then sneak back in 2 o'clock in the morning. Guess who's gonna be up waiting on you? But when you ask a woman, if I could just impose this, if you ask a woman what makes a great man, it's not so much someone who's got a lot of money or a great title or is trying for some aspect of social greatness, but it's somebody who gets up in the morning and may not have the most, the greatest job in the world, but they'll still put their work clothes on. And they'll walk right out that door. They may not be feeling all that well. Come on, somebody. But because they have this job, they are obligated to go, and they fulfill that obligation. Somebody who comes home at night. Can I get a witness? And somebody who takes care of their children. Can I get a witness? Greatness does not depend upon whatever achievement you have, but it depends upon you being steady from the inside out. Amen. 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 Sound like I got more women saying amen than men on that one. We got to learn how to get out of our own heads and be empathetic to what's happening in our situation. We got whole communities that are being decimated right now. Violence, poverty, come on now. All kinds of ills. It does no good for us to just get ours. I'm going to get mine. And I'm not going to worry about anybody else. There's no godliness in that. We got to be able to reach out from beyond ourselves and help somebody. I'm here not because of my own volition, but I'm standing on the shoulders of men and women in my life. And because they sacrifice, I'm talking about folks who weren't even part of my family, because they sacrifice so that I could stand here this morning, I need to be able to give back in some way or another. Simon didn't understand that. He thought he could buy his way into greatness. Greatness is not for sale in the church. It's about being a servant. Two disciples, one named James and the other one John. Don't know which gospel writer was correct. They either approached Jesus by themselves, or another gospel writer said they put their mama up to it. But they approached Jesus and said, when you get into your kingdom, put one of us on your right side and put the other one on your left side. And Jesus says, are you willing to drink the cup that I'm about to drink? And they said, yes, we are. He said, well, I see that you are, but who is determined to be on my right side and who's determined to be on my left side? It's not up to me, but it's up to the Father. Long as you put your shoulder to the plow and do what God asks you to do, that's all you need to do. See, some of us are looking at how to be a man. Well, the way to be a man is to put your shoulder to the plow and to be able to work for your family and to help the community and to be able to stand on your own two feet and not be ashamed to say, it's not about me, but it's about God, to come in church on a Sunday morning and to be able to give God the praise and to say hallelujah. I get tired of folk who get on this thing about, if I only had enough money, I'd be a better man. Or if I lived in this section of town, I'd be a better man. The devil is a liar. As long as you got breath in your body, as long as you wake up in the morning and realize that God has given you another day, that's the road to greatness right there. You gotta learn to sacrifice. You gotta learn to be a servant. There was an example that was given to us. And there are those of us who look upon our lives and we say, we haven't done enough, and we don't know if we've done enough for God. I've got some good news for you this morning. That there is someone who went before us, who paid the cost for your manhood. Can I get a witness? There's somebody that has already paid it all for you. And when you stumble and fall, because the price has already been paid, you can get up the next morning and start again. I was talking to a friend of mine who was in recovery, and he was asking me some questions about our mayor here in Boston, because he watched the convention and saw him talk about his own recovery. And I was talking to him, and I said, yeah, well, how long have you been in recovery? And he said to me, 3 years. Now, I've known this man for the better part of 40 years. And when I last seen him, he was in recovery, and he had been in recovery something like 27, 28 years. So when he told me 3 years, that meant that at some point he stumbled and that he fell. I said, well, are you all right? And he said, yes, I'm all right. He said, I still got Jesus. He says, as a matter of fact, when I was stumbling, I had Jesus. When I fell, I had Jesus. And when I was down, Jesus said, get up. There was a man who walked this earth for 33 years. And at some point, they dragged him from judgment hall to judgment hall. And they hung him high, stretched him wide, and dropped him low. And on a Friday, he died. But early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. You want to be a man? Follow Jesus. You want an example? Follow the example of Jesus. Jesus didn't have anywhere to lay his head, didn't have a fancy condominium, didn't drive or get on a fancy donkey. He was a man of modest means, but he followed the will of his Father all the way to the cross. How many of us men are willing to stand up and be the man that God wants us to be able to share the load with one another, bear one another's burdens, care for one another, care for our family? Can I get a man to stand up in this place and to say, for God I live and for God I will die? Is there any man in the place that'll be able to raise up their hands and say, glory, hallelujah, I love the Lord. He heard my cry. He pitied every groan. Somebody say, yeah.